Hello, everyone. Welcome to the Build for Informal Sector Hackathon webinar series hosted by Techrity. We have been having a series of webinars. Yesterday, we learned about the agile approach to building successful software products. Today, for the webinar for today, we'll be looking at scaling your project idea using the Lean Canvas method. This webinar, Build for Informal Sector Hackathon webinar, is hosted by Techrity, and the registration is still open for teams. If you wish to participate, contribute your skills to social good, you could still register your teams to participate. You can also join the Slack channel from the links that will be shared on the chat. Like I said earlier, Techrity is the host of this webinar. Techrity is a non-profit social enterprise who helps kickstart beginners in tech careers by providing vital resources like data, laptops, and mentorship support. To kickstarters. We also have the mentorship program, which we connect mentors to specific persons who have the skills. We connect mentees rather to mentors who have skills like coding, product management, project management, writing, to these mentors. So mentors will mentor these mentees throughout the mentorship program. So we also have the Build for Social Good Hackathon, which is what the Build for Informal Sector Hackathon 2020 is under. The Build for Social Good Hackathon program is one of the programs from Techrity, and it's aimed at identifying specific challenges for teams to build and provide solutions for social good problems. Hackathon participants also get access to mentors to support and direct them during the hackathon phase. So at Techrity, we are all about engineering a community of givers for technology across Africa and beyond. For more details about Techrity, you can check out our website at www.techrity.org. You can also send us a message on hello@techrity.org and also follow our social media channels at techrity.org. These links will be shared on the chat for you. And like I said, today we'll be looking at a very important topic, which I've also come across during when participating in hackathons too, the Lean Canvas method, scaling your project idea using the Lean Canvas method. And our speaker for today is Richard Tamunotonye. Richard Tamunotonye is passionate about creating solutions that will not only meet the exact needs of people, but he also brings joy, and excitement, pleasure and fun, and beauty to people's lives. He has over 5 years of experience working as a UX designer, and during his career, he has worked across several industries and sectors, ranging from education, government, health, startups, and nonprofits. He currently works with Digital Product School as an interaction designer, and he contributes to solving real-world problems with a cross-functional team. You can follow at Richard Tamunotonye on his social media handles on Twitter at ismerich, ismerich. You can follow him on Facebook at ismerich. You can follow him on Instagram at ismerich. The handles will be shared on the chat also. So in a short while, we'll be handing over to the speaker, Richard Tamunotonye, as he'll be talking us and telling taking us through the lean method, scaling, how to scale our project idea using the Lean Canvas method. Welcome, Richard.
Thank you very much for that wonderful introduction.
So I'm going to share the slides. You don't need to.
Okay, so, I don't need to.
Yeah.
I can't share. I would have loved to share it myself.
Okay. Go on, you can go on.
Okay, so just make me a host.
All right. Okay. Okay. Yeah. You can share now.
I can share now. Okay.
Yep.
Perfect. So, can you see my screen?
Yes, I can.
Okay. So thank you very much for having me once again. Like, I'm really excited, and especially the team you guys are focusing on, creating solutions for social impact, which is something that I'm really passionate about. Not just creating solutions, but also solutions that work within our environment. So today I'll be sharing, no need to talk much, but I'll be sharing insight on how we could work with the Lean Canvas model, the Lean Canvas method, basically what it is and how we can apply it for our ideas. So scaling your product idea using the digital, the Lean Canvas method. So already I've gotten a very wonderful introduction. I am Richard Tamunotonye. A brief about my experience. I work with Udacity as a UX mentor, where I coach students that are currently enrolled in their UX nano degree program. I also work as an interaction designer with Digital Product School and also the Bavarian Ministry of Digital Affairs, where we are working on a solution to digitalize all public services by 2022 in Bavaria. So I'm also the founder of Neural Lab, a creative agency currently based in Port Harcourt. So, and I'm also passionate about writing content related to especially creative design. So I write for Prototyper, and I'm also passionate about community, like anything that has to do with individuals coming together to see how we could learn from each other, share experiences, and also have fun, like count me in. So that also pushed me to start a local community of interaction designers here in Port Harcourt, which is the ISDA chapter of Port Harcourt. So that is a brief intro about me. So what is the Lean Canvas? Some of us might be hearing it, getting to hear this for the first time. So the Lean Canvas basically is a one-page business plan template that helps you to deconstruct your idea into key assumptions. Lean Canvas is designed to help you create a quick snapshot of your idea, share it with someone for feedback, and refine it iteratively. So all these are like big grammar, I understand. So basically, like in one word, the Lean Canvas is a one-page, like one page in one sentence, the Lean Canvas is a one-page business plan. So one thing that differentiates the Lean Canvas from a normal business plan is that from the Lean Canvas, you can get insight about everything, literally everything about that particular idea. So with that, why Lean Canvas? So we want to reduce risk and build successful product fast. So there are two major highlights, like why we should apply the Lean Canvas method to our ideas. We want to reduce risk, the risk of failures, the risk of push failures, when I say push failures, massive failures, and also build product that are more successful, and also build them, not just build them, but also build them fast. So the Lean Canvas is one approach I like when it comes to creating solution, in the sense that normally we might have an idea and we'll decide, we can say, okay, fine, let me just build this idea, all the features at once and put it out there. And after building these ideas, at the end of the day, we discover that people might not use it, or it is not solving their problem, or maybe solving a particular problem, but not from the user's point of view. So the LinkUp has helped us to like look at what can we build now and split those processes, those functionalities, and why building with tests. Not instead of building an entire product, then testing, you build component by component and test to see how people are going to relate to this product and how it's going to fit in the market. So I have some examples of successful products that have been developed using the Lean Canvas approach. So the first one here is Zappos. I don't know if you have heard about this brand before. So Zappos started with an hypothesis that, okay, what if shoes can be sold online in 1999? So, you know, that was when like e-commerce was just, the e-commerce market was just coming up. So they were like, what if people could buy shoes online? And what do they do? Definitely, it would be a bad idea if they should go ahead to purchase several amount of shoes and putting it out there on their website and testing to see if people will buy it. So their idea was, okay, why not we take these pictures from local stores and see how and advertise it on our website, and when someone wants to purchase it, it goes to these stores and pick them up and deliver it to the person. So at that point now, you notice that like there was low risk in the sense that they didn't have to purchase several amount of product and put them on their website. So there was low risk. And also they were able to like come up with a minimum viable product with low implementation costs. And also like they were able to understand the processes involved. For example, how long can it take to deliver, to get the shoe from the store to the client, and all those various parameters that are necessary. So they were able to understand the underground processes that we are involved in running this business. So fast forward 10 years later, they evolved to $1 billion revenue. They evolved to $1 billion revenue company within 10 years and was also bought by Amazon. So another startup I really like is the Airbnb. So I don't know if we all know how they started. So Airbnb started from just like based on the need. So these guys were like, they needed money, and there was this conference going on within their location. So, and all the hotels were fully booked. So they were like, okay, what if we could rent out our airbed and people will pay for it? So they tried it out, and like, people were really interested. So at first they called it Air Bed and Breakfast. So that is where the word Airbnb, it's an acronym, Air Bed and Breakfast. So they started it. At that point, I see that there was low risk because they were the owners of the air bed they were renting out. And when they tested it, that, yeah, people are actually interested in it. They tested the hypothesis and they went ahead to come up with a full product, which we now see today as Airbnb. So, which is one of the unicorns that have changed travel experience for many individuals globally, and also a tested business model. So, why do we encourage applying the Lean Canvas model for our ideas? So, due to the high risk and low costs, it is recommended to validate assumptions and iterate potential solutions from the beginning. Most of the times, the ideas we have are based on assumptions. Assumptions in the sense that there are no facts backing our ideas that, yes, if we launch this product or if this idea comes to the market, people are going to use it. Those facts are not there. So now the Lean Canvas comes in that place for you. Each aspect of your idea, test it and see how you can build fast. So at the discovery phase, like we encourage individuals to like test those ideas, test it not with based on their own assumptions that yes, people are going to use it. Test it, checking out who are the people going to use it, the customer aspect. How are they going to use it? How is this particular idea going to generate revenue if we launch? What are our channels of advertising? So that those are the parameters that the Lean Canvas tries to consider. So even if you are going to fail, you fail fast and reiterate. Unlike building a complete, taking a longer time to build a complete product and only for you to launch the product and discovers that the product doesn't meet the market. So for the Lean Canvas, even if there is room for failures, but you fail fast and you will be able to come up with a more successful product at a shorter time and a lesser cost. So this is what the Lean Canvas model looks like. So I'm going to explain each aspect of it bit by bit for us to look at. So the first aspect is made up of the problem, the customer segment, the unique value proposition, the solution, the channels, the revenue, the cost, the key metric, and the engine of growth. So I will explain each aspect of the Lean Canvas as we go through this section. So what are the advantages of the Lean Canvas, the advantages? I've already mentioned some of them. So it emphasizes to work fast, concise, and effective in early product phases. It promises a process-oriented and entrepreneur-focused business plan. It focuses on problems, solutions, key facts, and competitive advantage. And it enables the handling with insecurities and risk. So like I've said earlier, with the help of the Lean Canvas, there is a lower percentage of risk, lower risk, and also it helps us to build fast and also test our assumptions, because like I said, most of the ideas we have are based on assumptions, things that we think, okay, fine, people are going to like this because maybe we have experienced those challenges. But the Lean Canvas helps us to test those assumptions we have. So some tips about the Lean Canvas. The Lean Canvas is based on hypotheses. I've said that hypotheses are just things that are not backed up by facts. We assume that, okay, we try to test those particular assumptions to make sure that if they are true or false. So there is nothing which cannot be done in the Lean Canvas. So you can do virtually anything on the Lean Canvas. So you move and delete current post-it and new ones. I'll show you that and keep the canvas up to date. Show it on a prominent spot and talk to other people about the canvas. It's a living document. So briefly, what all these points are talking about is that like a Lean Canvas is not fixed in the sense that once you have created a Lean Canvas, you can't change it again. It's something that is flexible. So as you are testing your assumptions and hypotheses, you change it to suit something that is going to be updated as time goes on. So that's why, like I said, it's a living document. So as time goes on, you iterate and like update what each aspect of the Lean Canvas. And so the first part of the Lean Canvas is the problem aspects. So the first thing is for you to define the problem. What problem are you trying to solve with this idea you have? What problem do you notice? What areas, like, what is the particular challenge you have identified? Not the solution necessarily, but the problem you have, the specific problem you have identified. So sometimes we mistakenly like put our solution instead of the problems or the solutions we are looking at. Okay, but this aspect, the problem aspect, talks more about the specific problem in that, and it should be represented in a very easy and simplified manner. So one good thing like you should do while writing your problem statement is ask why. So there is this rule I normally recommend. It's called the five whys. So the five whys is more about getting to the root cause of the problem. It gives you, like, most times, when you write a problem statement, you discover that the problem you have written is not actually the root cause of that problem. So by the time you ask why, it would need to take you like before you ask why for like five times, you get closer to the root cause of that problem. So a good example for that is, for example, you say no light or no electricity. That is a problem. That is a problem. We all know that. But by the time you ask why into that problem, why is there no light? Okay, PhD. PhD are in charge of the electricity aspect to not give us light. Why? Then you ask, why didn't PhD bring the light? You'll say something got bad. So by the time you ask why, to the fifth times, you get closer to the root cause of that problem, which is something that you should tackle. Not just the surface, but the root cause, because it will help you like come up with a better solution. So for example, if we should say, okay, fine, let's use no light as a problem and come up with a solution for no electricity. Might not solve the cause, the main, might not get to the root cause of the problem. So that is still the same thing. Like, what is the problem behind the problem? So by the time you ask why five times, you will get to find out the problem behind that problem. So most often, it is not just one problem. So focus on the top three. So sometimes, like for the problem we have identified, like there might be 3 different problems or 10 different problems inside like that particular problem. So you can focus on like the top three. You can just prioritize, okay, fine, which areas should I tackle? Then look at those areas to focus on. So under the problem aspect, you also have alternatives or workaround. So for that problem you have identified, currently how do users, like what are the alternatives? How do users try to solve that problem? Which tools do they use? How do they try to like get around those problems? So that is what that aspect of the link canvas talks about. So you should try to write out, for example, the light, the issue of electricity, the problem of electricity I raised earlier. You can see alternative workaround are like generator sets, solar panels. I think those are the two popular ones like I could think of. So that is that. So this the second aspect is the customer segment, which is very critical for the link canvas. Because you are designing something or you are building a solution, you should be able to identify the individuals that are going to be using this particular solution. Okay, so you ask questions like, who has this problem? What do they have in common? Who could be interested in your solution? Different user segments are possible. So a very short story, I don't think we have time for that story. So at the end of the day, when you are able to identify your customer segments, you'll be able to build your solution to meet their need. So for example, if you assume, okay, I want to, I like using this example, I want to design an application that connects local farmers in the village, buyers in the city. That is a very good example. Now, that is a solution. You're trying to come up with a solution. But now, what if after you build that solution, you now discover that maybe, for example, you designed an Android application to solve that particular problem. And after you developed that application, you now discover that the farmers in the village, they don't know how to read. They can't read. They don't even have Android phone. There is poor internet service in the village. So at that point, because you are not able to identify your particular customer segment and build your solution to their needs, you have successfully wasted time and resources at the end of the day. So that is why it's very important for you to understand your customer's segment. So the next part is early adopters. So the early adopters, so after you have identified your customer segment, the early adopters are more of the first set of people that you are building this product for. Yes, sometimes we see my product is for everybody, which might be difficult, and sometimes I totally don't agree with that. So the early adopters are more of the first set of people that really need this product, who will use this product at first, who has the biggest demand for this product. Okay, so that is it. And the next part now is the unique value proposition. The unique value proposition. You have a wonderful idea, it is fine and perfect. Like, I want to create Uber for Port Harcourt people, or Uber for the next Uber for Lagos people. It is fine, it is localized, it is cool. But now, there are competitors out there, there are people out there that are doing something similar, something, the same idea you have. There are several other solutions, or there are several other alternatives to what you are doing. So what makes your idea unique? What is that additional thing that you have added that will make people go for your own solution instead of the what others have built? So that is a unique value proposition. So what is the differentiator? Why are you different, and what to get attention? What could you write on your landing page to sell the product? Make sure that the difference plays a role. So like I said, for the Uber example, maybe you have an idea like, okay, fine, you want to design Uber for Port Harcourt people. It's fine. But what is that thing that will make people in Port Harcourt to use your cab service or to use your ride hailing service? You have to think about that. So if they just exactly, maybe because this thing is a Port Harcourt thing, unlike other, you need to still look for something that really differentiates, that will make people come for your own product. So the next aspect is the competition. So as you can see, it works, it's very relative to the unique proposition. So the best way to come up, the easiest way to come up with the unique value proposition is for you to understand the competition. So it's when you have understand, okay, who are the key leaders in this particular idea, or what are the key solutions that the top solution that are related to what I'm doing. So you ask those questions, and it's only when you have find out those competitors that you can now maybe go back to the drawing board and see what am I going to do to stand out. So there is a serious need for you to understand the competition. So do you know your competitors? Who promises the same or a similar customer value? Who solves the same problem? So you identify them. So these competitors might not be necessary. For example, if you are doing an online service, they might not be necessarily online services. They might be services that also operate online or that deliver similar value with what you do offline. So you try to analyze it from various aspects and see how you can come up with a better, unique proposition. So the next aspect is solution. So for the solution aspect, the essence of, like I said earlier, the essence of the lean canvas is for you to reduce risk, build fast, and come up with a more successful product. So in summary, like, it's more like coming up with an MVP, fast testing, going back, iterating, coming back with another solution, like with a better solution, iterating, getting insight and iterating. So at the end of the day, your solution must not be 100% complete, okay? must not be 100% complete. You ask yourself, like, with this idea I have, what is the least thing? What is the like smallest thing I might need for me to like test the market and see if people might be interested in this product? So, for example, I want to create a website that connects skilled professionals to clients in Port Harcourt. I'm using Port Harcourt, for example, because I'm in Port Harcourt. So I want to create a website that links creative professionals to clients that are in Port Harcourt. And now the website might be a bit complex. It might cost me more for me to create a website. So at this point now, using the link canvas approach, I can decide, okay, why not come up with, instead of building a website, why not come up with a Facebook page and maybe a simple spreadsheet where I compute the list of creatives that I have available that are in Port Harcourt, and maybe do an advert to see if clients are going to like request for these services. So through there now, you see that I've been able to like congest the entire process for me to get insight of what people might really need at the end of the day. So no need to work it out completely. Just outline the easiest approach you can imagine to address that problem. So that, I think that says it all. Like, what is the easiest way I can solve this particular problem, and try to see how you can apply it and test. So you should also keep in mind that you should be open to change your solution. So like I said, it's an iterative process. There is no permanent solution at all. There is no best way to go about it. There is no permanent solution. So it's something that when you test, you get feedback. You should be open-minded for you to say, okay, fine, let me change. I think this solution can be tweaked to make it better or to improve on it. So the next aspect is channels. So you have identified your customers, you have gotten your unique proposition, you have come up with your solution, you have written down your problem statement and all that. So now the most important, another important thing now is the channels. So now these customers you have identified, or these clients you have identified, these potential users you have identified, or the target group you have identified. So how are you going to reach them? That is where the channels come in. So how are you going to assess them? Okay, so how do you reach your target group? Which existing channel can we use, and which additional channel can we develop? Do customers recommend our products? Think online and think offline. So most of your customers, are they offline or online? How are they going to see that, yes, a product like this you have come up with or your idea exists? So that is where the channel comes in. Are you reaching them through online, for example, social media, Google adverts, and all that, or offline through maybe billboards, word of mouth, and all that? So that is another aspect you should consider while developing your ideas. So here's another important aspect, which is the revenue. So yes, we are creating solution for social impact. In as much as it's social impact, I think it would be very good if even after launching, the idea should continue to run. Okay, so it must not be like more of making profit from that idea. If it's left for you, maybe I don't want to make profit, I'm just doing it for my community. But you should also ask yourself, how are you going to sustain this product or this solution you have created? So that is another critical aspect. So that is where the revenue comes in. So how does your business model look like? How much are people willing to pay? Is it a one-time payment or is it a recurring payment? How high is the margin? Is upselling or cross-selling possible? So you should ask yourself, like, okay, fine, how am I going to generate money to sustain this product or make profits from this particular solution? So that is another key questions you need to ask. Is it based on, okay, fine, users are going to subscribe or maybe through ads or so? Those are some sensitive questions to try to answer in the revenue aspects. So another one is the cost. So you should try to plan the cost of running that solution. Okay, so the cost can be fixed or variable cost. When I say fixed or variable cost, like I mean there are some costs that are dependent on the activities that are happening. For example, maybe the cost of you are selling a polo t-shirt and the cost of producing one shirt is 500 naira. And so we see that that is a variable cost because it increases. For example, if you design 500 shirts, it means you'll be spending about 2.5 million, sorry, 250,000 for the variable cost. So the cost of the production depends on how many shirts you produce. So that is the variable cost. So fixed cost can be, for example, the cost of your house rent, because once you have paid it, it doesn't matter if you produce 1 million shirts or not, it's fixed, so it doesn't change. So those are some of the parameters you should also consider. More matters of expenses as reminders than concrete numbers. So another thing is the key metrics, which is really important because you can't know the direction or how successful or the direction of your product if you don't have a key metrics to check out everything that happens. So what the key metrics is what criteria, like what are the criteria you use to define if your product is successful or not? Okay, so for example, the earlier example I gave where you are creating a solution to connect creatives to clients. I can say the successful metric is if at the end of the day, I have 10 bookings or 10 contracts from my advert, I can call it a key metric. So how do you rate success for that your idea? How do you know that? It might not be something that is very big, but how do you know that you have made progress while implementing that solution? So it's very important. So example is business figures versus product figures, and also new users versus returning users. How many users are coming using your product for the first time, and how many of them are coming back to use it? So also think about qualitative valuation, like reviews. So for example, like the reviews you get on your platform or on your social media channels. So they are also part of the key metrics to know, to identify that yes, people are actually buying into your solution. So on that aspect, which is the last aspect of the lean canvas, is the engine of growth. So the engine of growth is, to some extent, is a bit related to the acquisition aspect. So it talks more about the mechanism to achieve sustainable growth. Yes, you have launched the idea, you have tested it, but now how do you maintain sustainable growth? Like how do you continue to improve and like take that your idea to the next level? So that is what the engine of growth talks about. And so there are three major engine of growth like they use. One of them is the paid engine. So these are like the aspect whereby you pay for you to get more customers. Okay, you pay to get more customers. So that is where the advert, online advert, and all that comes in. So that is more of a pay engine. Then we also have the sticky engine, which is very sweet in the sense that like customers like to come, they just like your product, they just get, they are used to it, and they just stick to that your particular solution. So this is one of the sweet spots. And also we have the viral engine, which is the best in the sense that they don't just use it, they also share feedback with others. They also bring other people to come and use and experience that solution. So I think that is it. Thank you very much. You can connect with me on virtually most of the social media channels on my handle, just Ismirish. So Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, LinkedIn, just same name. So if you just search it on Google or something, you can connect with me. So you can always reach out if you have any questions and like projects you're working on that you need one or two insights. So I'm very available to contribute and assist. So if you have any question, you can ask.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Richard. You're right on time. We just scheduled time. We have one question in the chat. Please, is there a software that does Lean Canva?
Yes. I think there is Lean Stack. There is Lean Stack. And so I also created something. So let me share my screen. So I will share the link with everyone. Can you see my screen?
Yes, we can see.
Yeah, so yes. So previously, like some companies, what they do is they use the link canvas is online. You can download this, you can print it. So they print it on paper, sheet of paper, then maybe write on top directly. But it's not effective in the sense that what if the office get burnt or something happens on the, along the line, so you can easily lose track of that particular document. So I use a tool called Miro. So I will share this link with you. So anyone that is interested in, you can copy it and modify it. So you can easily digitalize. This is more of a digitalized way of doing the Lean Canvas aspects, in the sense that you can share it with multiple people, multiple individuals, and also different people can contribute at the same time. And you don't lose track of your document. So these are the various parts. You can just write, you can write on the sticky, the problems you have, your solution and all that. And at the end of the day, you can share it with stakeholders. Now, another important thing that just crossed my mind, let me share it. So another important thing that crossed my mind is the Lean Canvas is, like I said, it's more like a business plan. It's more like a business plan. So it's something that from time to time you need to share with others in order to get feedback about your idea. So at a glance, the Lean Canvas gives an overview of everything that's happening around your particular solution. So it's something that from time to time you share with people that are more experienced, business partners or like investors and all that. So it's for them to have an idea, because some people don't really have time to go through a 40-page business plan. But at a glance, they could see your Lean Canvas and have an idea of the entire operation, not just the business aspect of it, but also the solution aspect. So they have an overview of everything that is going on. So I've shared the link. You can check it out. So there's another tool online called Lean Stack. So you can create a business, a Lean Canvas easily from that tool also.
Thank you very much, Richard. This webinar was awesome. I believe hackathon participants have learned a lot. We learned that the essence of the Lean Canvas is to build an MVP fast, and your solution must not be 100% complete. Richard has also given us many ideas, and we believe that the participants have benefited immensely from this webinar on scaling your project idea using the Lean Canvas method. Well, as he said, there is no permanent solution and no best way to go about it. This is what the Lean Canvas method is all about. It's a very good method for iterating fast, and it will help the participants a lot to not focus on features which are not necessary for their MVP. Thank you very much, Richard Tamunotonye, for this webinar. And you can still join the Slack channel. You can still find the team. The link is on the chat. And this webinar too, the recording will be hosted on YouTube, which will be it will be also be shared on the Slack channel. Please share your experience about this webinar, tagging at ismirich and at techrity.org with the follow with the hashtags which were shared on the chat. Thank you all for attending this webinar. Thank you, Richard. It was awesome having you here. We have learned a lot, and we believe that hackathon participants will go ahead to use this method in their when iterating and when building. So we have come to an end of this webinar. Yeah, and also we appreciate you taking out time to take to teach participants about the lean method. And we hope that next time when we call upon you, you oblige.
sure. You guys are really
thank
doing,
you.
You're doing a wonderful job. Like, I really thank encourage you to like continue. Don't stop. Like, we need more of this. Let's continue. Thank you for
thank
having
you.
Me. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you. So we have come to an end of the end of this webinar on scaling your project idea using the Lean Canvas method. Thank you everyone for attending. Bye.
Bye.
Bye.